Apply now for the Morris Fishbein Fellowship in Medical Editing. This is a unique one-year fellowship offered by JAMA to introduce physicians to all facets of editing and publishing a major medical journal. The application deadline is January 5, 2025. For more information, including how to apply, go to jamafishbeinfellowship.com.
From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Author Interviews. Conversations with authors exploring the latest clinical research, reviews, and opinion featured in JAMA.
Hello, and welcome to our listeners around the world. You're listening to JAMA Author Interviews, and thanks for joining us. I'm Dr. Gregory Curfman, and I'm the executive editor of JAMA. I'm speaking today with Dr. Leora Horwitz, who is a professor in the Department of Population Health and a professor of medicine at NYU Grossman School of Medicine. Dr. Horwitz was one of the lead authors of a brief report now published at jamanetwork.org, which is titled 2024 Update of the Recover Adult Long COVID Research Index. Dr. Horwitz, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
Now, Dr. Horwitz, let me begin by asking you, why did you undertake a study of long COVID, and why did you decide to conduct your study now?
Well, long COVID is now defined by the National Academy of Medicine as an infection-associated chronic condition that occurs after SARS-CoV-2 infection, is present for at least 3 months as a continuous, relapsing, and remitting or progressive disease that affects one or more organ systems. And this is a newly recognized condition after a new virus that affects large numbers of people. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, the CDC, has consistently found that about 15 to 18% of adults have ever experienced long COVID, and presently about 5% of the U.S. population has it. In the U.S. alone, that's more than 15 million people. So Congress and the NIH decided that long COVID is something we urgently need to study, and they funded the RECOVER initiative, which stands for Researching COVID to Enhance Recovery, to better understand what long COVID is, what causes it, what we can do to treat it, and how we could prevent it.
Great. Thank you for that. And how did you approach your study of long COVID? And specifically, what was your methodology?
Well, what we did here is we enrolled people who had exposure to SARS-CoV-2, who were infected with COVID, and people who weren't. So we have a comparison. And we enrolled almost 15,000 of them at 83 sites across the country, 33 states plus territories. And we asked all of them every 3 months whether they had experienced any of about 50 different symptoms. And based on that, we tried to understand what sorts of symptoms or combinations of symptoms would help us to define or to understand or to explain long COVID. So what we did in this study is we took a look at the symptoms that people were reporting who had had infection and the symptoms that people were reporting who had not had infection. And what we were looking for were symptoms that were more common in people with a history of infection and that were lasting, in this case, at least 6 months, so that we could try to identify which were the characteristic symptoms that were really different between people who had infection and people who didn't have infection.
All right. Now, can you tell us about your principal conclusions and what are the criteria for the diagnosis of long COVID that you identified?
So first of all, what we found is that every symptom just about was more common in people who had had infection and people who hadn't. That is, people who had been infected with SARS-CoV-2 virus were more likely to experience any of 40-something different symptoms 6 months on. So this seemed to be a really multifactorial, multi-organ sort of disease. Within those 40, 50-something symptoms that people were experiencing, we found that there were 11 that were especially more common, that if people had a number of these 11 symptoms, they were much more likely to have been infected with SARS-CoV-2 in the past than not. And those symptoms were post-exertional malaise, which is a special kind of fatigue. It's what happens to people after they do some amount of exertion, mental or physical, maybe not even that severe. And then a day or two later, not right away, but a day or two later, they get exhausted. So post-exertional malaise was one. Fatigue, just general fatigue. Brain fog, so trouble concentrating, trouble focusing. Dizziness, especially on standing. Palpitations, racing heart. Change or loss in smell or taste, thirst, chronic cough, chest pain, shortness of breath, and sleep apnea or snoring or stopping breathing when you're sleeping. Those 11 things collectively were the most differential between people with infection and people without infection. And for each of those, we gave them points depending on how different they were. So for example, people who had not had infection in the past pretty rarely reported that they couldn't smell. But people who had had infection quite often reported that they couldn't smell. So that got a lot of points. And as opposed to fatigue, where many people who hadn't been infected in the past reported some fatigue, it's pretty common, and so that got fewer points. So collectively, we assigned each of these symptoms some points, and we added up those points. And what we found is that a score of 11 or more was most differentiating. That made us feel that people who had 11 points or more were almost all previously infected. It's pretty unusual to have 11 points or more if you were uninfected. And so that made us feel like that was a pretty good way to distinguish people with long COVID from people without.
Okay, now, if I remember correctly, there were about 20% of the patients in your cohort who met the definition of long COVID. Is that correct?
That's correct. But what's important is that our participants in this study are a mix of different sorts of people. So we include people who had infection years before they signed up for the study and people who had infection just within the past couple weeks of signing up for the study. And we include people who never had infection at all. So we're not claiming that this is a perfectly random distribution of people in the country. We know that if you had infection a couple years ago, you're probably more likely to sign up for a study of long COVID if you're still having symptoms. So we're not saying that it's likely that 20% of the people in the whole country have had long COVID. But what we do find when we look at people who were enrolled within 30 days of their infection, that number, the proportion of people who meet the definition, who meet this threshold, is very similar to the rate that the CDC is reporting. So we think that this threshold is pretty reasonable. It probably captures just about the same number of people that, for example, the CDC is finding in its surveys.
Now, how will your definition of long COVID be applied in clinical practice? How will doctors understand this definition of long COVID and actually utilize it with patients?
Well, this definition, this threshold is really not intended for an individual doctor taking care of an individual patient in front of them. It is certainly possible that you could have just one symptom that is clearly new, clearly because of the SARS-CoV-2 infection that is causing you trouble, and that you might not meet this threshold of 11 for. So we're not making the argument that you have to have the various symptoms in this measure to have a diagnosis by your own doctor of your own situation. Rather, the point of this is to help researchers. So right now, the definition that the National Academy of Medicine put out, which is the definition that clinicians are using, so a new symptom that is lasting 3 months or more, that definition is nice and general, as it should be, so that individual doctors can make the appropriate decision for the patient that's in front of them. But as a researcher, we really want to make sure that the people that we are calling long COVID can be easily replicated by someone else wanting to do a research study. We want everybody to understand exactly who our population is when we are doing studies of long COVID, and we want others to be able to replicate that. We don't want to accidentally put a lot of people into our long COVID group who don't have long COVID, have something else. So the point of this threshold is to help researchers identify a robust, rigorous, concrete, well-defined, easily replicated group that we can study, and so can everyone else, so that we're comparing apples to apples when we're doing studies of long COVID.
All right. Thank you very much for that. This is a very important clinical condition. And I wonder if you have any final thoughts for our listeners about it.
Well, the first thing I want to say is that long COVID is certainly real. We don't have a blood test for it yet. We don't fully understand what causes it. We don't have great treatments for it. But at a minimum, we can really be pretty confident that this is a genuine condition. It is not in people's heads. They are not malingering. They are not making it up. They are not being lazy. These are people who are genuinely suffering real consequences of a new virus that they had not been exposed to before. That's the first thing. Second thing is, we hope that these symptoms that we're describing here as being the ones that are the most differentiating will help people recognize that they might have consequences of long COVID, or help doctors recognize the sorts of things we see in long COVID, so that there can be better recognition, better management, better treatment. And then finally, of course, we hope that researchers will adopt this threshold so that we are able to appropriately compare studies. This helps us to come to some understanding of the pathophysiology, of the treatments, of the prevention, of the demographics, of the risks, so that we can much more quickly achieve scientific discoveries.
Well, this has been very interesting, and thank you very much for your insightful comments, Dr. Horwitz.
It's a pleasure.
I'm Dr. Gregory Curfman, and I've been speaking with Dr. Leora Horwitz about long COVID. You can find a link to her JAMA article in this episode's description. This episode is produced by Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.